four. It's full in Nativity Hall. It's a great name for a hall to have Advent four together. And we have some room for those who come in after to sit in the gallery and to welcome everyone who's here today. We will, as we go through, offer some special directions and invitations for movement, especially in the outset. Wanted to acknowledge it's a little different, and I'm so glad to be here with you all on this fourth Sunday of Advent. Blessed are you, holy and living one.
You come to your people and set them free.
Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
That your Son, Jesus Christ, at his coming, may find in us a mansion prepared for himself, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. We invite children to stay here with us and worship today.
Second book of Samuel. Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all of his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in the house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving around in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any tribal leaders of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel, and I have been with you wherever you went, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones on the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel and will plant them so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. An evildoer shall afflict them no more as formerly from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house, your house and your kingdom shall be made sure before you. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Hear what the Spirit is saying.
Thanks be to God.
She was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Be seated.
Does anybody go to movies anymore? I actually went out last month with Tammy and a friend, watched an entire movie in an actual theater. It was the first time in a movie house in a long time, maybe at least a year. It was strange to be there, yet also strange. I've been thinking about a particular aspect of the movie-going experience as something vaguely analogous to this journey through Advent we've been undertaking. Universal experiences, or most commonly shared experiences of moviegoers, is the waiting. Arriving early, room filling up until we're all sitting together as a bunch of strangers in the dark. Letting the anticipation build toward that blockbuster, perhaps, that's been promised for the last 18 months. It's finally here. Well, it's almost finally here. The lights fade to nearly total darkness. A hush overtakes the room. A few fleeting seconds of quiet. And then a burst of light. Full spectrum of sound all at once. It must be time. This is the moment we've been waiting for. It's just a reminder to turn off your cell phone. Keep them in your pockets. Then back again to dark and quiet again until another shock to the ears and eyes. Things start off intensely with the first of a half dozen trailers for upcoming shows. The randomness is part of the experience, each preview sharing little in common with the others in genre, in content, even in quality, or even with the show you're actually there, that you've actually brought your people to see. It can be jarring. It is jarring. Previews are often entertaining, but they are beside the point, and they put off the coming of the feature presentation. They put it off, and they put it off. Darkness, sudden light, a shock of sound, and then nothing that you expected. Then more waiting. Repeat. And it feels more than a little to me, like the rhythms and the themes unfolding in Advent to me. This movement through this season. Now here we are on this fourth Sunday. We've already sat with the darkness, absorbed bursts of light and sound. Whether the prophet's promise of salvation for God's people, the baptizer's call to metanoia or turning the banks of the river, and his promise of the Spirit coming, or the call of John to see anew, and is pointing at Jesus as the true light. And of course, the darkness is not just thematic. It's not just abstract. So I've been thinking about it this week. I believe we should name some of the darkness that is surrounding us and threatening, it feels, to close in on Advent. Like violence and human suffering in Israel on October 7th, and now for more than 2 months in Gaza. More than 1,000 Jews killed in October, and more than 100 hostages still held, and also more than 20,000 Palestinians killed. Many children, and about that many more injured by Israel's retaliation, ostensibly to eliminate Hamas while inflicting desperate suffering on the entire Palestinian population. They're trapped, literally. War rages still in Ukraine, nearly 2 years after Russia began this invasion, in that 1,000 civilians have been killed, nearly 20,000 injured, and nearly 500,000 lives lost as casualties among those fighting the war. And don't forget all the global jockeying, the implications for the world order as this crisis unfolds. Women's reproductive rights repealed or under threat in nearly half of the states in this country, including in Texas, where a woman was recently rebuffed by the Supreme Court of the state because she had to go to the Supreme Court of the state for permission to get the medical care necessary, and forced them to travel elsewhere for her treatment. And political upheaval around the world, advances being made in many places by leaders with authoritarian aspirations, happening as a poignant background to the threat that is ongoing here in this country. I believe the light is real, and it's good for us to remember the darkness is real too. Not just some faraway place or long, long ago, but even in our time, in our day. All this is just the tip of the iceberg for many other instances unnamed, whether at a global level, or in our circles of relationship, or in the troubles in our own hearts. So the darkness has surrounded this Advent in ways that we clearly see, and we clearly feel, and under which many clearly suffer. And now another burst of light. Another burst of light. The visitation of the angel Gabriel to Mary to announce God's coming into the world. Conscription of Mary's participation in it. And Mary's response of faith and praise. The contrast must be stark and striking, but the backdrop of the world as it was and as it is, and God's word, God's promise of a new hope, if we can bring ourselves to say yes. Maybe even the promise is almost too much to believe. That what will come through Mary, and in a different way through us and our own yes,
is God's very self coming into the world to dispel the darkness, to create a way for light, to create life in the light. The 20th century theologian Reinhold Niebuhr once reflected that perhaps preaching Christmas should be left to the poets, and then lamented that so few of our preachers are actually poets. How nearly impossible it is, in the midst of darkness, to grasp the wonder of the promise, to dare to hope for God, for whom no suitable house could be found, built of wood or stone, and instead making a home in a human womb and in the flesh of humanity to walk with us and all creation back to light. So Mary is the poet today. My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed. The Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, to his descendants forever. And we continue to watch and to wait just a little longer. Amen.
Amen.
Pray for peace, justice, and reconciliation throughout the world. We pray for the honoring of human dignity and for the relief of the oppressed. we give thanks for all that is gracious in the lives of people. We pray for the renewal of the church in faith, love, and service. We pray for bishops, ministers, and for the life of this community. We give thanks for the gift of your word, the grace of the sacraments, and the fellowship of your people. We pray for this local community and for all people in their daily life and work. We pray for the young and the elderly, for families, and all who are alone. We give thanks for human skill and creativity and all that reveals your loveliness. We pray for all who suffer pain and loss, for those without housing, who are food insecure, and who experience addiction or mental illness. We pray for victims of violence, war, and natural disaster, and for all in harm's way. We give thanks for the peacemakers and advocates who work to make the world whole. We pray for those who are in need, for the sick, sorrowful, and bereaved. We pray for all who bring comfort, care, and healing. We give thanks for human love and friendship and for all that enriches our daily lives. We especially pray for those on our prayer list and for those we name silently or aloud. We commend to God's mercy all who have died, especially those we name silently or aloud. Let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and love of God.
God, our rock and refuge, keep us safe in your care and strengthen us with your grace, that we may pray to you faithfully and love one another boldly, following the example of Jesus, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God.
God, have mercy. We confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior, Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins, all goodness, and eternal life.
Amen.
Peace of Christ, the peace of the Lord, or the peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Invite you to sign our guest book, and you can find that as you go down the stairs today, making your way toward the exit. And we would love to know that you were here and how we could reach out to you the next few weeks. learn more about you and share more with you about St. Michael Angelus. There's a little bit more going on today than just this. Just this would be enough, but we're going to do it four more times for Christmas Eve. We have Christmas Eve services beginning at 1 o'clock in the afternoon in Spanish. At 4 o'clock, the famed Nativity play. I cannot wait for my first time to see that and experience it. And then at 6 o'clock p.m., in the church, and at 10:30 with carols, and 11 o'clock beginning the festive mass for Christmas Eve. So, probably see a lot of you again, and many who are watching at home or just waiting and biding their time, I look forward to gathering throughout the day. One note for those who are joining us via live stream, JT has come down with something, and so we can't be here today. So this morning's service is being live streamed on my phone. Sorry for the sound problems if you're having them. We will have live stream for the Misa at 1 and the Nativity play at 4 and the 11 o'clock service, the 10:30 carols and 11, but we will not be on live stream for the 6 o'clock service. And we're sorry, we just don't have anyone to run it at 6. So we'll see you again at one of those other times online. What else am I forgetting today? There's a lot on your red sheet. We invite you to look at the Advent and Christmas giving tree. There are still lots of ornaments there. Each ornament has a way for you to share a gift with one of our community partners in this season. And we would love to have that tree emptied of ornaments and then sitting over top all kinds of gifts next week. We invite you to take another ornament or a first one, wherever you're at in your process, and it's on your way in the gallery, on your way out the door today. Please look at your insert, and we want to invite those who are celebrating a birthday.
I still have calendars that have not been picked up, and I still have calendars that you can purchase. So I will be in the parish hall after service.
Great. Thank you. If you're celebrating a birthday or some other milestone today, we invite you to come forward so we can pray for you and celebrate with you. Hi, Tim.
Hi. I'm Tim Sackett. I'm here to hopefully celebrate a new anniversary this Friday, the successful replacement of my right hip.
Offer prayers for Tim all week long, and I'll offer a special prayer for you as we go along. And yes, sir.
I'm John Skindell. I have a ordination to the priesthood anniversary this week.
Okay. The
19th.
Number 59.
I don't think I can walk up there without my cane. But like Tim, I had a left hip replacement a number of weeks ago, quite a few weeks ago now, and I'm recovering. And I wasn't able to come up, and Carlisle loves to join me. Two of my children had birthdays in the last number of weeks. My son turned 40, which was a real milestone. My daughter doesn't like to talk about how old. But I'm very thankful that I'm recovering and wish the same for Tim. Yeah.
Thank you, Julie. We'll offer prayers for your children.
Thank you.
Let's pray the prayer together. Oh God,
Christ in your hands, look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Wonderful celebration. Thank you.
I'll hang a little bit behind you.
When we receive communion today, it's going to be tricky. We will invite you to come forward to receive the bread here from Scott or Scott. And then to, first of all, it will be this section, and we'll invite you all to come up. And then the chalices will be over here. And then you can make your way back in a circle to your space. Once we have served this section, the the choir might be done with the anthem and might have cleared the aisle over here by then. And so we'll invite this section to come and do the same, and the chalices will be here, roughly, approximately. And then the choir will come up the aisle, receive communion, and make your way back to your space. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have. These are the sacrifices that are pleasing to God. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to God our Creator.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who in the fullness of time came among us in flesh, and open to us the way of salvation. Now we watch for the day when he will come again in power and great triumph to judge this world, that we without shame or fear may rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels, with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and maker of all. Jesus stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Celebrate the memorial of our redemption, Almighty God, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling Christ's death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in Christ. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And in the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, our Savior, by Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Sorry to interrupt the prayer.
Of the soul. Virgin Mary, the obedient to your will. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen.
May the Sun of Righteousness shine upon you and shed light upon your path. And the blessing of the one holy and triune God be with you today and remain with you always.
Amen.
Bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.